Hey everyone, my name is Dr. Galatea Strong. After getting a 100% on my NPTE, I co-founded SPTwithME. We do mini courses on NPTE material to help DPT students who are just about to take their NPTE actually understand content versus just trying to memorize everything. If you enjoy what you see, check out SPTwithME.com for our 3 and 6 hour course. Now onto what you're actually here for, let's talk about capsular patterns. First off, what is a capsular pattern? I think that the best way to describe this is to actually picture what's going on. So let's use this example of this picture, the shoulder joint. Now realize that even though we are talking about the shoulder joint, this can be translated to any joint in the body. So think about the knee, the hip, the elbow, etc. But let's say something has happened to the joint capsule. It's irritated. It could be something like rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis, an infection. It doesn't matter, just know that the joint capsule is affected. Now, compare this to when you injure a muscle, right? For example, you get a quadriceps strain. So you should know that all muscles can do is just stretch and strengthen. So if you stretch or try to apply resistance to a person's quadriceps that has been injured, you can assume that there is going to be some limitation with these respective tests, and the person is probably going to experience some pain. The same idea goes with an affected joint capsule. So there are certain ranges of motions that are very unique to each specific joint in the body that are going to be more affected than others. So what's unique about this situation is that there is a proportion. And what I mean by this is that there are certain movements of the joint that will be more affected than others. So an example, let's go back to the shoulder joint. Think about adhesive capsulitis slash frozen shoulder. A telltale sign that this is what's going on is that this person's shoulder will be most limited in passive range of motion into external rotation. They're also going to have range of motion deficits into abduction. However, it's not as intense of a limitation as that going into external rotation. Additionally, there is also a range of motion deficit going into internal rotation. However, once again, it is not as intense or significant as that of external rotation or abduction. Now, considering this, it doesn't mean that flexion or adduction are not affected, since I didn't mention those. But this is just the pattern of the proportions of limitations that we'll see. And this is just through tons of research that have been done over time. So this is obviously not an exhaustive list, but here are a few that I feel like you should keep in mind for the NPTE. So if there's anything going on with the joint capsule of the digits, your patient's going to have a harder time flexing their fingers versus extending. If we're looking at the knee joint, people are going to be more limited in flexion versus extension. So think about knee osteoarthritis, that's how they present. Now, even though both the glenohumeral and femoral acetabular joint, so the knee and hip joint, they are relatively similar, it's a good example, as shown in this slide, where if you look at each respective joint, they are all unique in its capsular pattern. So it's nothing like the other. So for example, you look at the shoulder joint again, it's mostly external rotation, then abduction, then internal rotation. Then with the hip joint, the most limited range is into internal rotation, then flexion, then abduction. Completely different between the two, even though the two are similar in a sense. Hopefully, capsular patterns actually make sense now. If you enjoyed this content, again, check out SPTwithme.com for our 3 and 6 hour NPTE mini course. Last but not least, take a look at this reference if you need any more information.